गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीबडी, मायसेल्फ विवेकानंद सिनकर, सीईओ फ्रॉम स्कोप। इन लास्ट थ्री यू मेट माय कलीग मिस्टर बालासाहेब डोईफोडे, ओनर द सेल्स मार्केटिंग। आई एम लुकिंग फॉर द ऑपरेशंस एंड द product specialist group. Today in this fourth series, we're going to have a technician on the very part of power system, the data. Almost people are familiar with the in day-to-day life. They are facing certain issues like the integrations of the various protection schemes into the etc. Today we will cover basic introduction of the SCADA and also how you choose about the SCADA. Along with, I have my colleague Mr. Bakar Arabali. Bakar, please. And another colleague, Mr. Sushil Kumar. Mr. Sushil Kumar.
Hello,
so
everybody.
With this introduction, I hand it over to the Mr. Bhaskar Arabali. Bhaskar, please.
Yeah, thank you very much. Good evening all. I hope my voice is clear to you. Am I audible?
Yes, Bhaskar sir, you are clearly audible now.
Okay, fine. So today's our topic is mainly we will be discussing about the SCADA, Supervisory Control and Data Acquisition System. This is the fourth day of our seven technical sessions, where most of the our presentations are more involved in the electrical systems testings and new technology in the systems and the different areas we are touching upon during these sessions. So today is our topic is SCADA system. Let's see what is our agenda today. Today we are going to discuss on the introduction of conventional substations, SAS based substations and digital substation. So this is mainly we will be discussing about the evolution of the substation over the decades, and second one is what is exactly the SCADA and the role of SCADA in power sector. And then we will be talking about communication protocols, then practical industry problems. What are the different problems we are facing while we are dealing with the SCADA? Mainly it is when it comes to the integration problems, different OEMs relays integration with the SCADA system, or different protocol integrations and interoperability. These all are the various issues industry is facing that also we are going to discuss. Then choosing the right SCADA, what is the main features we should look into while we are purchasing the SCADA. Those all are the things we need to understand before we are going to purchase any SCADA or implement any SCADA in your system. Those all are the things also we need to discuss. So this particular topic we are going to discuss is that. Then success stories, like as a scope, we have implemented many places of our SCADA system. So I'm going to show three, four projects where the difficult integration has done with the successfully the operations without any much integration problems. Those cases I'm going to show you and I'm going to explain you. so that the attendees or the engineers who are there here today's session will understand. One is basic what is SCADA. They understand at the end of the session. They understand the SCADA. They understand the different SCADA systems used in the electrical system, different protocols used in electrical systems. What are the difficulties facing in the SCADA system or protocol integration areas, and also how we can able to clear those issues or successfully integrate those different protocols, different interoperability issues. Those all are things. Once you understand this thing, so you will be able to have some clarity on your minds after this session. So with this one, I'm starting my session. So my topic starting is that we will look at how the substations or evaluations happen in the substation. So when you see that the decades ago, the substations are more like a conventional substations. You can see that the big control panels are there, big, very huge control panels, huge protection panels, and there are a lot of cables running from your substation to control room. So the cables are through the trenches, through the walls, through Jameen say, all these things, and all these things we used to see when you see this, the conventional substations or old substation. Even though today also mostly 50% to 40% substations are conventional sort of substations. So conventional means there is no automation. Everything is a manual system. Like when you go to the transmission segment, you have a lot of substations which are almost SCADA-based substations in transmission sector. When it comes to the distribution segment, the problem is around 80% or 90%, I can say, are conventional substations where there is no SCADA. And the new substations which are coming up in the distributions they are going to have an initial stage itself as a substation automation system. This is what you can see, that when you see that conventional system, the major conventional system is, you see that the one part is at the substation control room, second is the substation switchyard. So substation switchyard is mainly, you can see the transformers, you can see the breakers, isolators, switches, all other areas you can see in the switchyard, and all these signals are carrying through the copper wires to the control room. And in control room, you can see control panel and relay panel. These are the main panels you can see in the control room, where the operator will sit in front of the control panel and see the different signals on the control panel. They also noted down what are the different alarms, annunciations are going to happen there. And they also see that the switch positions through the semaphore indicators, or even they record the energy parameters in their logbook or ledger, event logger. All these things are manually, you can see here. So here, you can see everything, like the representation of the bay is mainly, you can see that semaphore through the semaphore indicators or through the LEDs. And if you want to operate the breaker, the operator will come and open the breaker through the switches. So, and operator want to note the energy parameters. There are the meters you can see here, like the ammeter, energy meters, or voltmeter, or megawatt, megawatt meter, frequency meter, all the meters at this control panel. And any alarm, if we want to see that what are the different alarms and where it has come, so he can recognize from the annunciation panel. So this is entirely completely a manual process, and every time operator will log all these events by writing into the ledger book or log book. So these all are the, again, a manual thing. So everything the operator or engineer should be intervened to operate any switches or any breaker in the substation. This is what the conventional system normally follows. See, you can see here, this is what you can see, the conventional substation where operator sits and see monitor all the signals through the control panel. So the main drawback of this system, you can see here, one is the main drawback is manual intervention. So every time the person who sits at that particular controls room has to write it down, everything. And he can put it all, the whatever the things he noted down at the control panel, he go to the control panel, see every periodically he take the energy readings and put it in the notebook and come to here and put it in the ledger. He write in the ledger, and in between while doing this, if any alarm comes or any event happens, the breaker trips or anything happens, he's no clue on that what exactly happened. So it is, again, he has to drop everything and he has to run to the control panel and see that what is exactly happened there. He has to see that what exactly happening in the control panel, through the control panel. And then he has to run to the alarm system and he has to reset the alarm. Then he has to run and put it all this particular event in the log. So at the end of the time, the operator have a lot of things to do. And during all this process, what happens? There is some error happens at his end, or some mismatch of the events, or he may forget to write down the events or forget to write down some important alarms in the logbook. So entirely, it's completely, since it is a completely manual system, so the human error is more huge in this particular conventional substation. So over the period, to reduce this type of things, people are started automizing this particular part. When it comes to the control part, when it comes to the data acquisition part, so people are started using the automation into this particular area. Even when it goes to the primary equipments, there is no much automation happened. But when it comes to the controlling the switch gears, controlling the transformers or breakers, parameterizing or putting the energy values. So we have done some automation in this area. So that's what right now we are using, the substation automation system. The mostly 99% of our substations are the SAS substations are this type of substations where you have traditional CT. Traditional PT, matlab conventional CT, conventional PT, which gives the 1 ampere secondary input CT or 110 volts the secondary output voltage output, and the breakers having tripping coils or closing coils and transformers and some GI system. These all are still connected with the copper cable to the numerical relays, and from numerical relay, we have done much automation in this part, which is from here and above areas. Like from relay, protection relays, we are using protocols like from energy meters or from the voltmeter, ammeter, or MFM. We are still using the Modbus protocol to communicate with our substation automation system. Or from relays, most of the today's everybody is moved from the static relays to numerical relay, and numerical relays to numerical relay with 61850 protocol, IEC 61850 protocol. So most of the relays are communicating to the substation automation system through the 61850. Earlier, the relays are there. There is a protocol which is being used to communicate to substation automation is IEC 60870-103 protocol. So still some old relays are there. Still they are communicating with the substation automation, because this 103 protocol is a serial protocol, not IP-based networking protocol. But when it comes to the 61850, so most of the customers or most of the electricity boards are adopted this technology as a standard technology, a standard protocol, and purchasing their relays with the 61850 feature. So communication from relay to the substation automation system mostly on the 61850 is happening. A few some relays still have the Modbus protocol, which are communicating to the substation automation system. So in this case, people are using the protocol converter again, the Modbus to the 61850 and send it to one, or some softwares or some SCADA systems are already having the feature of parallelly take the different protocols. Like they take 103 as a protocol directly, there is no protocol conversion. There is a 61850 also directly taking to the network, or Modbus also they can directly take the network, and through the switches to the some media conversion, they take every these things without protocol conversion, they take these data to the substation automation system. From this system, they can also put the gateways, send it to SLDC, state low dispatch center, or national dispatch center like NLDC, they used to send it. So this is what we have right now. Mostly all our substations are SaaS-based substations are having this type of configurations. But technology still evaluation is going on, happening, and people are concerned about how we can reduce the copper usage from the switchyard to the control room, because still we are using the copper cables. So most of the people are started coming up with a solution called distance substation. So there are many things we reduce the copper cables, many things we reduce whatever the issues we are facing in the substation automation system. We are addressing those issues in the distance substation system. But before going to distance substation, I just want to see that what is the disadvantage. Main disadvantage is yours in the substation automation size based substations are like still you are using the copper cables. So it is again a problem, because when the copper cables, most of the electricity board, if you see that the copper cables which are running through the trenches having very bad shapes over the period, because people will not use or used to maintain those copper cables or maintaining the trenches. So after some time or some years, these all cables are messed up with each other, and you could not able to understand which copper cable is belongs to which bay, or which cable is belongs to which signal. So it is very difficult for an engineer or a site engineer to recognize. So if any problem comes, it is very difficult for an engineer to trace the cable. That is a main issue with the copper cables. And second is he cannot segregate the main cable with the problematic cable. So mostly you see that there are unwanted tripping happens, and you see that protection is everything is good when you go to the protection relays and see that what is the problem. So everything seems normal, but the unwanted trippings are happening on the line or on the transformer or on the some other area. So if you trace out what is exactly those problems, so you will be surprised to know that there are many unwanted trippings are due to the DC leakages or due to these DC leakages through these damaged cables. So the battery normally get drained quickly due to these leakages, due to these cables breakages, cable rusting problems, all these things. So it is very difficult for an engineer or site engineer to understand and rectify it. Even you want to rectify it also, it is very difficult because there are so many damaged cables and you don't know that what cable is carrying what. So it is very difficult for a site engineers to understand. So this is what still we are facing the problem in substation automation systems. So this is what the disadvantage of substation automation system, where you have a semi-automized your substation, where the substation control the switchyard to control room is still we are using the copper cable or manual system, and from the relay and above we are mostly automated the system. So this is what the substation based SaaS based substation we are talking about. Then comes to the digital substation. This is the what fairly a new technology, and we have not done much installation in India. Very few pilot projects have done with some OEMs, but in other countries or throughout the world, these digital substations are coming up. They are checking the performance of the digital substations and seeing that the other difficulties, and then maybe in future, next another 10 years time, you will be slowly going towards the digital substation, where today's world is mainly having more on digital, more on the issues that how to reduce your space, the substation space, how to reduce your control panels, how to quickly identify the problems. All these things, the world is looking at those solutions. So digital substations are fairly addressing those pain areas where the conventional substations and substation automation systems are facing. So this is what normally you can see here. Digital substation means there is a difference between people says the digital substation. Digital substation means most of the your CTC LAK, from CT, PT or breaker to the control room, everything is on digital. No single copper cable is being laid for this particular signal carrying purpose. So that is what the complete digital substation. I'm going to explain what are the digital substation, what are the things in the digital substations. So if you see that switchyard, so all your CT, PT and lightning arresters, transformers, breakers, these all signals are being carrying through the optical fiber to the relays, and relay have a special module which accept the digital signals from the CT. If you see that the normal today's conventional CT gives the 1 ampere secondary current, but when it comes to the digital CTR, electronic CTR, optical CT, when we are talking about optical CTR, optical PT, what happens? Everything, the output of the CTR PT is into the mostly the sampling values are digital values, and there is a merging unit which will conditioning their signals and send it those signals on the protocol called 61850-9-2 or 9-LE, the light edition wala. So the 9-2 is morely a sampled value signals being carried from CT or PT to the relays. So this is what a complete copper is been eliminated, and in the place of copper you will be laying the single optical fiber so that all the signals will be sharing through those optical fiber to the relays, so different relays. If you see that, if you go to the actual system of this configuration of the digital substation, you can understand the actual digital substation there, what are the different things in the digital substation. You can see here the circuit breaker and the electronic CT or optical CT. There are two different CTs, or electronic VT or optical VT. These all are being connected with through this optical fiber to the merging unit. Merging unit is mainly a unit which will condition the signals from the CT or PT. So if the signals are not proper or they condition, they send it a proper way to the relay. So from here, you can see, I'll add some You can see here, from here to relay, the complete signals are on optical fiber. Those protocols are normally 6850-9-2 protocol being used to send it, these CTPT signals to the relay. And relay, whatever the relay today we are using may not be support these particular signals to take this CTPT, digital CTPT signal. So your relay must have a support the 9-2 protocol. So maybe today the hybrid relays or numerical relays also having the option of adding this particular module, 9-2 protocol module, to the existing relays, even though they are taking the analog signals from the CTPT. But future, if you want to change that particular analog CTPT to the electronic CTPT or optical CTPT, so that's still without changing the relays, you can just add the modules, optical CT module, optical PT module. Still, you can use use that relays. So again, from here, the relays to the substrate SCADA system and to the LDC or SLDC, so that the normal way of 6850-2-1, this protocol being used, and you can monitor. So this is like the presently what we are using, same way you are going to use there also at the bay level and station level. But process level is going to change with the optical fiber. This is what mostly the digital substation about. And this is what the some sort of differentiation between the conventional or substation, SAS-based substation, to the digital substation. You can see that the above picture represents the SAS-based or conventional substation, where you can see from the transformers, from the feeders or breakers, lot of cables are going to the control panel, control room, where control room is having full of auxiliary relays, protection relays, backup relays. All these things are being used in the control system. But when you see that the digital substation, the below picture, if you see and compare with the top picture, you see that this particular copper cable is being completely eliminated, and a single optical fiber cable is being laid from the substation to control center. And all these are connected with Ethernet switches, with some other bus. It can connect with the bus, and all these signals are shared by everywhere. And you can see that the number of control panels also reduced. Like, instead of using nowadays what you used to do that for feeder protection or line protection, you have a one panel for the control panel, one is the relay panel. So in control panel, BCU and all other control systems or meter system will be in one panel. Second panel is more dedicated to the protection panel, where you see the main one relay or main two relay or backup relay or their auxiliary relays, LBB relay, and all other relays normally lies in the control, the relay panel. But when it comes to digital substation, most of the auxiliary relays are being eliminated. Like if it is a tripping in conventional or SAS-based system, you still use the master trip relay to trip the breaker. So, but when it comes to the digital substation, when there is a fault happens, the relay detects and it will give the trip command through the goose message to the breaker. Then the goose message will flow from the relay to the breaker in the digital format, and from the breaker end it will recognize as a trip command and it will trip it. So you don't require again a master trip relay here additionally, where your relay itself directly give the digital signals to control the breaker. So that's why most of the auxiliary relay system is reduced, so that your panels, number of panels are going to reduce, or quickly you can identify the problems. Any problems in the network, any problems in the signal failures, any problems in the networking. So your control HMI will inform you that where is the problem and what are the problem and nature of the problem. Everything you will be notified through your control panel or your HMI, through HMI you can understand, so that the person will directly go to that particular problematic area and clear about those areas. So that's what this particular digital substation is going to take place in coming days. Only thing is that still it is evaluation is going on, so we are not sure that how much we can reduce and what are the last aim of this particular concept is not known to us. People are just taking the pilot projects or pilot based substations and seeing that the advantage over the SaaS based substation. So this is going to happen next coming years. This is what the actual substations, how their evaluation has happened in during this last 2-3 decades. Then coming to the our main topic, the SCADA system. So all these systems are again related to one way or other way related to the automation system. Means how effectively you are making your entire electrical system converting into a digital format and making your system so flexible, and all the data which you are getting from the sensors, from the RTUs, from the relays, how you are storing and how you are utilizing for the future analysis purpose, and how you are using those data to identify the issues. All these are again related, and people are badly required that there is something which we need to have a system which will tell operator or engineers or electricity boards the problem or the issues or analysis purpose. So there should be one system. That's what the SCADA system or other systems are coming up, and people are started using widely this SCADA system. So our topics are mainly we go into the topic. So SCADA system. So before going to the SCADA system or more about the SCADA, there are many various systems are used in the electrical automation system. So I just want to put it those systems so that people will not confuse. Some people say the SaaS system. Some people say that SCADA. Some people say that EMS or DMS. Or nowadays, the new technology is coming and everybody is talking about ADMS. So we should understand what exactly the meaning of these different terminology or different systems. So when you see that, you see one is the SCADA. We people are talking about SCADA. It is called as a supervisory control and data acquisition system. People are calling, when it comes to the substation level, people are calling a SaaS based substation, where you say that substation automation system. And when you go to the generation, when you go to the big distribution segment, people say that EMS system, they are using the EMS system. When you go to the transmission and the distribution, you may hear about DMS, distributed management system, or outage management system, or ADMS, advanced distribution management system. These are all the different systems people are using in the electrical system, mainly into the electrical systems. So I just want to put forward these things instead of going deeply into each and every subject. See, SCADA is mainly, it's simple, it's like a supervisory control and data acquisition system. It means SCADA takes the data from relays, from RTU, from sensors, or from primary equipments. All the data it will take, it will have some of a control to control the breaker, control the isolator, control some of the auxiliary system in the substation. So SCADA is mainly to collect the data. Raw data will be collected. If it is from bay, they collect the data of energy data from the energy meters or transducers and store it here. Or the status of the breakers, status of the isolator, the SCADA will collect and store it in his database. When it comes to the SaaS or EMS, energy management system, these all are more like analytical system. By using the SCADA data, EMS will work on the analytics or calculations or something, user-defined outputs. So these all are mainly the analytical platforms where the SCADA is the main basic base platform, where it only take the collect the data. But if you put it the SAS, so SAS, what you would do, it takes the data collected by the SCADA as a reference and talk to the relays. So when it comes to the substation, what happens? Automation is different from the SCADA system, where automation is more like it also involves the protection areas also. Automation, like one relay is talking to other relay through the boost messaging, one relay is talking to tripping the command to the breaker and giving the boost message to the LBB system. All these things are automatically are interlocking in the BCUs. These all are the automations happens in the substation. And also SAS is using the raw data of which is been collected by the SCADA, like the actual SCADA which is been collected by SCADA, and you will have some analytical on the SAS system also. So what I mean to say that the other areas like EMS, DMS, OMS, ADMS, these all are the most like the application oriented softwares, where SCADA is the platform, main platform of all these areas. So that's what the difference between these two different terminologies. Okay, then what is SCADA? So mostly I during my the previous slide I explained about what is exactly the SCADA. SCADA is something like a supervisory control and a data acquisition system. The name itself will clear about what exactly the purpose of this particular system. And SCADA is it cannot be a standalone. It should be based a combination of software or combination of hardware. So the data is collected from the hardware, like sensors, like transducers, like RTUs, like PLC systems, or like relays. And those data will be analyzed, stored, and properly utilized for the future purpose in the software. So complete system is called a SCADA, where you will have, one is control the industrial process, electrical switches locally or remotely, or monitor, gather, or process the real-time data, or directly interact with the devices such as IED, RTUs, or HMI softwares, and record the events into the log file, generate the alarms, trends, and the comparison of the different events. Those alarms also can be done in the SCADA, and store the data in database for future analysis. This is what normally SCADA does. And what happened before SCADA? What is exactly before SCADA? I just wanted to see. I want to tell you that what is the necessity of SCADA nowadays? Before SCADA, before implementation of SCADA, what we were doing exactly? So before SCADA, what happens? The rare site has had a data acquisition system. Like you can see that old systems, mainly the old systems of generation plants and some other plants, there is a one DAS system. This is called DAS, a data acquisition system, have a own protocol. There is no there is a manufacturer defined protocol. They use it, and they used to collect only the energy data, and that is very slow, and people only bother about the energy data to be logged in. So for that purpose, normally people uses the DAS system earlier, and typically only analog data to store and show the update times. That's it. That's what they do it earlier before the SCADA. And this is the one area, and some areas like a critical substations make a 24/7 people will be deployed for monitoring the generators, monitoring the substations and pump station. So all these critical sites or critical equipments, dedicated people were there to monitor continuously those assets. And some sites were checked on periodical basis, like some sites like a manned during the day and checked daily, or key sites. Like some sites are important sites, but not very important sites. So periodical, instead of periodical checking, they put it every day for daily the routine checks are day they used to see that monitor those things, and night time they leave it. So they categorize the critical one, semi-critical one, and the interrupt-based assets. And these all are being continuously monitored manually. Like if you see that fourth point, some sites were visited on request, like switching off the voltage control, or you want to switch on the reactor, you want to switch off the reactor. So it's not a everyday task. So periodically you go to the reactor breaker panel and switch on or switch off and see that the things. So this is completely manual things, and manual intervention is required before the SCADA. And this normally creates sometimes human errors, sometimes human negligence, which causes problems. So because human beings cannot continuously monitor the system throughout day, because the energy levels of the human beings normally decreases with the time. So the way in the morning he comes and start observing the system, critical system, he cannot do the same way when he is about to leave the duty or put it the day of his duty. So there are many human errors, many accidents, or many things happens during this before the SCADA. Now, why we need SCADA? So with that, if you see that, one is that you reduce the manpower. You don't require every critical equipment. You require to put it one manpower continuously for the transformer, one manpower for the generator, one manpower for the critical pump, one manpower for the big pumps. Instead of that, you reduce those things, which will be monitored by the some sort of automation, some sort of SCADA system, which will tell you that if any problem comes, it will alarm you. It will issue alarms, or it issue events to the operator, so that the operator will understand and try to attend that thing. So using that SCADA, you reduce the most of the manpower, and closer monitoring of the conditions, like quick response to the outages, leaks, equipment issues, all these things you can quickly respond to those. Proactive actions to the maintenance system stability. So you, instead of waiting for the system to be failed, you will be having the indications or alarms to the through the SCADA that, okay, you will also schedule your shutdowns, and you will take the maintenance activity to reduce the failures of the system. So that's what you do it through this SCADA. Reduce the equipment damage, and early detection of the equipment failures also can be done it. So like notification of the problems can save the system interrupts on money. And field people better inform of failure. If any failure comes, at least we should know that where exactly this failure happened, what are the tools we required to carry to maintain that when this happens on the line or remote area, at least the person who is attending that problem is prepared and well prepared before attending that particular thing. So these all are things SCADA will intimate you or inform you about all these issues. That's what we need. And because in electrical system, day by day, the complexities happening, the more energy systems are more producers, energy generators, even the renewable energies are coming into the picture. There are many consumers are increasing day by day, many complicated systems, many transmission system also complicated, distribution is more complicated, even the generation are not at all the earlier system, like you generate and send it to the system. There are many small generation plants are coming up and connected with the grid. So it's becoming more complicated, and to maintain those things manually is very impossible to the human being. So there should be some system which will tell you the problems, which will tell you the issues, so that you reduce the outages, you reduce the collapse in the system, you reduce the disturbances and increase the quality of the power. That is main motto of this particular complicated network system. So that is what SCADA is coming to the picture and give you the great visibility to your grid and network. And this is what I explained that. Okay, then there is a ADMS system. SCADA is also I was telling you that SCADA is the main system. Based on that, the top on that, you can add ADMS, outage management system, substation automation, DMS. All these are just layers which will be added into the base system of SCADA. So what I was just discussing in my previous slide, this is what we are going to achieve using the SCADA, like a decision-based real-time information. Means when you are using the SCADA, you will have the real-time based information you will be getting in your system, and real-time decision-making also can be taken. And also you see that view and manage the state entire network down to even up to the meter level, up to the consumer level. From the generation to the consumer level, you can see that visibility of your network increases. Are analytical tool like a demand control, demand how the demand control or state estimation, or you want to see that ki tomorrow what is going to be my demand for the particular consumer. That also it will give you some indications, some projections to you, so that you will purchase or you will be ready with those to meet those demands. So that's what you have a lot of things you can understand from the SCADA system, so that you have you increase the reliability, you also control the meters, you control the losses, and you can manage the demands. You can also see the assets, and you can properly maintain those assets. You can increase the power efficiency. You can see the downside. All these things I have mentioned, that efficiency, or you can connect very well with the green producers, green like a renewable energies. Quality of the power also increases. And in the future, you can even are connected with the electrical vehicles. All these things also can be connected with the grid, so that you can also manage those electrical vehicles, electrical charging stations also through this SCADA. So this is what we have already discussed. So this is what overall, what is the SCADA, how the SCADA is important to us, and what is the importance of the SCADA when it comes to the visibility, when it comes to the stability and other areas. So now coming to the protocol, when it comes to the substation or electrical system, mostly we are using a standard protocols, because earlier we were using some proprietary protocols, but people are slowly discarded those proprietary protocols and just went on a standard or a open protocols, where you have you can avoid that integration problems, you avoid the monopoly of one vendors. All these things are benefited. So I'll just explain you what are the different communication protocols we use in the substation automation or SCADA system. One is that earlier we were using the protocols, proprietary protocol. That protocols are called a develop. The proprietary protocols are oftenly developed by a single vendor to use their protocols in their own protocols to communicate with their own other protocols, other products. They use a proprietary protocol. So something like a K-bus, PA, these are the manufacturer based protocols. If you give some other manufacturer and try to communicate with the this particular proprietary protocol devices, you cannot talk to those devices. So that is one difficulty of integration issues or monopoly of these things. So to reduce these things, mostly electrical networks or electrical system is come up with the open protocols, and most of our substations, generations, and distributions are using these open protocols. So these all are mainly, you can see that the earlier we were using a Modbus protocol. Modbus earlier, it was the proprietary, but then it has been open protocol it is available to everybody. So it became an open protocol for us nowadays. and the earlier old type of relays are using communicating on Modbus protocol. After that, relays started using the 103 protocol, that is called 60870103 protocol. This is again a serial protocol. Then after 103 protocol, completely we put it into the standard protocol of 61850. So these Modbus 103 protocol and 61850 protocols are mainly used in the substation. So you cannot use these protocols for the remote communication purpose. There are another protocols which are used for the remote communication purpose, like a 101 protocol. This is earlier we were during the PLCC, using the PLCC, we are using the 101 protocol. This is again a serial protocol. Now most of the people are using a 104 protocol to communicate with the control centers, like a LDC or SLDC or NLDC. These two protocols are majorly are widely using this protocol. So open protocols are normally a protocols which is not a vendor specific protocol. It is been designed by a community or a group of electrical communities which are being defined this set of rules, so that everybody should follow those rules. And when you are developing a product, so that today I'm giving my product, tomorrow somebody else is giving to you a different product. But if these two products you want to see in your SCADA system, so these two products should be integrated with the SCADA system. So when you use the open protocol or standard protocol like a 61850 or Modbus or some other open protocol, it is possible to integrate a different manufacturer's product into a SCADA system or automation system. That's what the open protocol and the standard protocol's advantage. So that you don't depend on a particular OEM. So tomorrow you have different relays in your lab, you want to replace with some other relays, other make relay with the different make relay. You easily seamlessly remove that relay and put it the relay and start communicating without much hassles in the system. So this is what freedom to choose any OEM by using this particular standard protocols. These are all the various architectures follows in the SCADA system. Why I was talking about the protocol is that when you are talking about the SCADA system, you should also know that what are the different protocols are used in the electrical system, and which are the substation protocols, which are the remote protocols, so that you will have some idea about how your relays are, how your devices are communicating with the SCADA system. So when it comes to the various architectures, so different manufacturers or different customers or different consumers are following different architectures. That is again based on their requirement, present requirement and future applications. So when you see that this expandable architecture, you see there are the SCADA servers are there. There are, if you want to tomorrow, you want to, today you only purchase one server and tomorrow you want to make it that particular server into a redundant system because today you have not having a sufficient fund. So you purchase one single SCADA system and tomorrow you want this particular SCADA system a redundant one. So then, and in future and tomorrow or maybe coming years, the IoT system is more prominent and taking place. So this particular your system should support that IoT protocols, IoT signals, where all these things you are sending into the cloud and from some other part of the world, people will try to see your system or people will try to monitor your system. That is also possible. So you, when you are seeing that or creating the architecture, you have to see all these things in your mind, keep in your mind to see that how the expandability will be. So based on that, you form or you finalize the architecture. So this is what the expandability is very important. Then the multi-servers, like you might be knowing that when it comes to the SCADA system, mostly what happens, disaster management system and other all management system are coming to place, where one server is totally down, so other servers will take over this particular activity. So all these things are or should support your SCADA, like a multi-server system or distributed architecture. Like you have one level of you can see the downside, that there is a picture distributed architecture where you can see here there is a one bus. You can add another bus so that you will be isolating some critical systems working on the separate bus, and the general equipments are connected with the common bus. So you can have this type of distributed architecture also you have to work out. So these are all the different architectures when you are discussing or when you are talking to the SCADA system. So this is what the orientation of the SCADA architecture or protocols. Now coming to the point, so most of the cases what our attendees are having, most of the cases they have own SCADA and they have are facing some issues, or most of our group is technical people and mostly site people. They know that what are the different issues happening are mainly when it comes to the automation, when it comes to the SCADA system, they may be facing a lot of issues, and people are at one point they fed up with the systems, because most of the cases when we are going to the customer and discussing about the automation system, so most of the customers are facing a lot of issues and they don't know how to address these issues, and only few people in their organization are able to understand the problem and try to communicate with their OEMs and get it those solved. But most of the cases what happens, many unsolved issues are still there in this automation system. So those all are, I put it in the system, in these points, like when it comes to the Bay extension and integration issues. So this is the major issues industry is facing the problem. Like OEM has installed or done the complete automation system and protection system, and he has erected the substation. So one OEM has done everything, and after 5 years there is a Bay extension has come. So this particular Bay extension bays are required to integrate with the existing SCADA system. There the most of the people are facing the issues, because the existing OEM, you have to purchase the existing OEM's BCU or relays so that it can easily integrated with the SCADA system. Or you have to again, the integrator who is doing the Bay extension job have to consult with the original, already the existing systems OEM, and try to give orders to them to integration all these things. So you don't have the freedom to choose this integration purpose. You don't have the freedom to take a different BCUs of different makes to integrate with the SCADA without the existing systems OEM's help. This is what everybody is facing, because it is again a mercy on OEM. If he supports you, then okay, you can able to integrate with the existing Bay extension base. If he is not supporting you, then you have to again put it another system where extension base are monitored by another system, or the old base are monitored by some other system. So you have to see the two different systems. This is what the common problem in the industry. And second is various manufacturers' devices integration. That is also a very critical issue, where if I have one OEM, if I have another OEM, I have 2-3 OEMs, when I'm making this, all this, even though they are 6.8.0 supported protocol, the integration of all these relays to the SCADA, again, you have to depend on different OEM. The OEM come, create a ICD file, ACL files, has to give it to you. Then the other OEM also do the same configuration in the relay and give it to you. Then all these things, you take the data, and configure in the database of the SCADA and connect, try to connect it. These are all the still the problems are coming, and people are, even though these all are easy to understand, easy to do it, but the OEMs normally create you that it is very tough job, or it is very, very complicated process, so that you will be depending on them. So they will be charge you for their services. So that's what people are doing in the SCADA system. Most of the automation systems, when I go to substations, the engineers, the executive engineers are, superintendent engineers are facing these issues, and they are not getting the support from the various vendors. That's what when they purchase any substation or protection system, they always prefer a single OEM. Like one OEM can give everything, so that the integration problems he don't require to run behind the different vendors. That's what he's trying to see, that how quickly he can do the work. That's what these problems are facing. And various protocol management, like one relay is on 6150. When it goes to the MFMs or meters, those all are on Modbus. Now, when you are configuring a system in the substation, what happens? Either you have to be on single 6150 if you are choosing. You have to be on 6150. Every equipment should talk on 6150, so that the HMI and the network is on the common protocol. So what happens if meters are there? Then you have to add the protocol converters. Some other meters are having DLMS meters are there nowadays. So you have to again convert those protocol into a standard protocol of 6150 if all other relays are working on 6150. So these are also a problem to the system, to the vendor. Extra hardware is required, for the additional hardware is required to convert those things. So these are the areas where protocol management also a problem industry is facing hugely. And data points, this is again most of the OEMs are playing with the vendors or the customers. Like today I give 5,000 data points, 10,000 data points to you, and what happens over the next 5 years, your system is increased, your data points are increased, and your 10,000 data points are not sufficient, then mostly OEMs are recommending that, okay, you change your entire SCADA and put it the new version of SCADA having increased data points. So entirely you have to scrap it and put it the new data points. Few OEMs still supporting that, okay, they charge you the extra data points and use the same the platform. But most of the SCADA vendors have like 5,000, 10,000 data points, have the one platform. More than 10,000 data points, they have the different platform. So when you use more data points, when you require more data points, you require to completely change the SCADA system. That is again a problem in the system. So, and third party integration issues are completely industry problems, and completely depending on the SCADA supplier for any additions in the system. Like they keep you or they educate you very minor things to you, where you daily day-to-day usage they train you. But when it comes to one relay you want to add it into the SCADA system or substation automation system, again you have to call the OEM, and OEM will charge you for the service charge or everything they charge you, and you completely depending on them to add those areas. So these all are again problems people are facing. And also the last one is the misconception of protection and automation should be from the single manufacturer. This is again, it is mainly particularly to the India. When Indian customers are more tuned to, or OEMs are more made them tune that, okay, if I'm giving a relays, you should purchase from SCADA also from that, so that your project will easily or quickly commission. Or if you go for the different vendor, then they have to talk to me, or they have to take the support. All these things are normally customers having this type of fears in their mind. That's what they try to mostly focus on the single vendor. But due to this single vendor choose, what happens? You are completely depending on a vendor. You don't require to understand or you don't require to study the software or SCADA deeply to add or to face if any issues happens, you can yourself can rectify it. Those things cannot be done with this type of single manufacturer's concept. Because if you go to the US and other developed countries, what happens? They only see that the protection, they purchase from the protection relays, protection system, and they are free to choose automation because this automation is more on IT platform. Until unless your relays are supporting a open protocol or standard protocol, you are freely choose any SCADA vendor which are more futuristic, because this standalone SCADA vendor give you more features, more flexibles, more they teach you more in-depth on the particular area, so that you are free to integrate one OEM, second OEM, third OEM is very easy in their software. That's what the US and other people are normally following this nature. They are free to choose any SCADA vendor, they're free to choose any production vendor, and they try to integrate themselves so that they will be handling the future issues, future integration problems, future protocol problems, or future the interoperability issues. These are all the industries are facing the practical problems. So to address these problems, one should normally try to see that when they are purchasing any SCADA system or when you are installing any SCADA system, they have to look into different various platforms so that in future they don't have issues or they don't purely depending on the people. So this is what the first going to the platform, you have to see that the latest platform is the .NET platform. This is mainly the Microsoft .NET platform. Normally support you your WPF or WCF. This is a Windows presentation foundation, Windows communication foundation. These all are the features. It will be added in the .NET platform. So tomorrow, if you want to add any protocol, it is a modular type. So you don't require to change the software. You just add the protocol, plug and play sort of thing. So .NET gives that opportunity to the software. They can then the graphical interface also. Nowadays, because you don't require to create a single line diagram, you don't require to create a pump hose pictures, or you don't require to create a turbine pictures. You can take from any JPG file or any PMG file and put it into your system and make those data points to be attached with that. So that's what the platforms are available, latest platforms are available on this software. So it is like a plug and play. So something like your Android, where you have a Android is a platform where you have one application you want to download, you can download from anywhere and put it here and try to start working on the platform. So platform is very important here. Then you try to see that the software or SCADA supports the multi-protocol support. Like all these other multi-protocols, I'm going to explain in the second slide, what are the different protocols you need to see it. Then if somebody is saying, I support 61850 software, my SCADA supports or relay supports 61850. So mostly you need to see that whether they got the certification from the international agencies like KEMA and other IEC certifications or independent certification bodies are issuing the certification, so that at least you will be assuring that your software, your SCADA software is satisfying all the rules which are being defined in that particular protocol. The finally, you have to see very carefully the cyber security. That is, you have to see that whether your software is NERC compliant or CIF compliant, cyber security or cyber security management system is strictly followed in the system. All these things are very important while you are choosing your software. This is what the platform then goes to the multi-platform like .NET, Linux, because everybody nowadays giving the software which is supports all these things. Like tomorrow you want to make Android compatible your SCADA system, so your SCADA is enabled are ready for the Android. Or nowadays people are like, if you go to the institutions, most of the projects are most of the automations doing on the Raspberry Pi is the one the processor. So that particular processor also you can connect with your SCADA system. So tomorrow, if you want to connect, like we are talking about smart cities. So tomorrow you want to connect with the electrical system and water system and your and any other systems to this single platform, your software should enable for that, like all these different platforms. And freedom to choose OEM protection, like I was telling you that, okay, you can choose any protocol or any manufacturer, OEM, so that you seamlessly integrate to your system. That's what you should have, that SCADA system. And infinite points. So your system supports, today you are going to purchase 5,000 points, but tomorrow you are planning to increase 500 points to 1 lakh point. They should not ask you to change the platform. Instead, this same platform can increase the points without changing the software. So that's what you have to look into that. And wide protocol range from 6.850 to 101, 104, DNP, Modbus, like tomorrow you want to add MQTT, like IoT, HTTP or MQTT IoT protocols, you can add it, like OPC, all these things. The wide protocol range also required to see that. And customization also important, like reports, features, modules. This is something like plug and play sort of modules. You can try to add it into the existing SCADA, but your SCADA should support. That is what you have to keep in your mind when you are trying to choose the software, like expandable architecture or minimal hardware configuration. This is also very important. So nowadays we are saying that lightweight softwares. So all your software should not occupy the most of your hardware, the memory. So your software should be very light so that you minimum space, you can get it more features. This is what you have to focus on the software when you're doing. And protocols, these all are the different protocols. Even though today you don't require, but tomorrow if you won't require, at least your software should allow you to add these protocols into your SCADA system. So I'm just seeing that these all are the different protocols. Then the important thing is the databases. So when you're taking the data from the sensors, but when this data, all the SCADA data, you want to give it to the external world, like your SAP system or billing system or some other external systems. So that is very important, how your this particular SCADA database integrated with the external world database. So these are the database commonly used, and your software should support this, like ODBC database, Oracle, SQL servers, Light SQL or MySQL. These all are the different databases are available, so that your software should support this type of database. So tomorrow, if you want to share all your data to some external world, so through this database you can easily connect with the others, the third world, other world softwares, or seamlessly you can share the data, like from the your other system to your SCADA system, or SCADA system to other system. This is both the direction you can do it. And data exchange files also very important. Like nowadays we are using XMLs, .csv or text files. So this is what your software or your SCADA should support, all these things. And certifications is important. You have to see the certifications. And the library, you have to see that the sufficient library in your system, so that you don't require to draw every isolator, breaker, and every parameters. You can try to pick from the library and put it the database into the system. So that is very easy. This is it, mainly the commissioning. When you come to the commissioning, when you come to the creating the database, this will come as a handy to you. So this is what the complete SCADA or general orientation about the SCADA, how we can choose the SCADA system, and what are the different platforms we have to see that, and what are the issues we are facing in the SCADA system, and how we can address while choosing the SCADA vendor. This is what you have to keep in your mind. now success stories. So with this as a scope, you people are knowing about Scope as a testing and measuring instrument company, manufacturers company, but most of the people in the industry knows as well that Scope has another division called protection division, where under this protection division we have these type of things we are doing. So I'm just trying to explain in one slide. Like in protection division, we are also giving the manufacturing, supplying, erection, testing, commissioning of control and relay panels and substation automation system, and design and retrofitting of the relays. We do more than 5,000 relays have been retrofitted so far from us, and supply commissioning of the control switching device also we are doing in the protection division. RTU based automation system also we are doing, and SCADA, OMS, DMS, these solutions, we have our own software, we are installed so many places and we are giving these services. We have AMU and PMU, like analog merging unit, our phasor measurements solutions also we have. Under protection division, we are also doing the power system studies, like relay coordination, or fault analysis, all other system studies we are doing. And also we are giving the consultancy service and audit power system audit services. These are completely protection division is doing this type of activities under the protection division. So this is what the protection division, just wanted to explain about what activities we are doing. That's what I just put in this slide. So now coming to the cases, what we have done and relatively what we have learned from this previous slides, like integration issues. So how we have done, these all are things I'm just going to put it one or two case studies, where MSATCL having a peculiar problem when in the Nagpur division, like Kaparkeda, they have a substation automation system, and that was working for 3-4 years perfectly, and all of a sudden their SCADA system or the SAS system is not working, and they are the MSATCL trying to contact the OEM, and OEM is suggesting that okay, you entirely change your SCADA and entirely change your relays, or take a new platform or new software, so that the system can be re-initiated. That's what they are suing, they are telling, and they are also telling that okay, they are asking the hefty money. That's what MSATCL has fed up with this type of monopoly in the system. Then they formed, because the MSATCL has recently formed another cell called a PAC, and now it has been changed to other name. But the PAC is like a protection and automation cell. Under this, there are engineers have been assigned, and they wanted to lend every software, automation software and protection system, and they wanted to do their own commissioning. They wanted to integrate the SAS system. All these things they wanted to do that in that particular within their PAC team. So they come up with the one tender called independent or third party SCADA solution, where there are many manufacturer relays, like ABB's relay is there, BCUs are there, even the Sifang is there, and some other renewable OEMs relays are there. Now what we done in this case, you can see this picture, you can see that we have not disturbed any existing system. The 400 kV network is same, and we have not changed any single relay, because earlier the OEM were recommending to change the relays also, change the entire system to make it SCADA system or automation system working. But what we did, without even changing or without your changing a single hardware, what we did, we simply put it one more PC and install our SCADA and connected to their existing network, this particular SCADA. So that, and from this software, what we do, we take all of ICD files or files without even taking the support of original manufacturer. We take all the data from the DCUs and configured, and then we initiate, we run, we commission successfully this particular SCADA system and train to the engineers, MSCTCL engineers. So during this training, they learned how to integrate the different makes relays, how to interoperability can be achieved, how to operate the breakers, how to take the signals, configuration, everything we explain to them and we teach them. And the beauty of this particular thing is that we only shown to them how to make this integration with the one bay, and rest of the other bays is been done by MSCTCL themselves. So without our help, we only give the some remote help, but they done themselves. Now after this particular this thing, what happened? The MSCTCL has purchased only the licenses from us. They don't even asking to come for the commissioning. Only they are purchasing the dongle from us and doing the integration works with the non automated stations. They are doing their own way, integrating the different makes relays and making their own database and running the commissioning the substation automation systems. So this is what we have done in the MSCTCL. And director O&M and MSCTCL top management has personally visited this substation and appreciated our efforts and appreciated the concept we are working on these particular areas, because most of the cases this is what even not only the MSCTCL, Power Grid also facing this problem. So that's what we have done it, and we wanted to make this as a special try to sell it that okay, you don't require to depend on a single OEM to make your substation automation systems. Instead of that, you take a dongle, you train on any software. Even I am not saying that you train on our software, you cannot take it from the other software, because when I am giving a standalone software, mostly all the features I am giving to you and I am training to you, so that any software you are taking, you can easily understand those softwares. But my what I was telling you, that you are free from the taking one OEM and depending on the OEM. Instead of that, you freely choose any software, any SCADA vendor to integrate with your existing system. That's what we done it here. These are all the things we have given the training to them. These are all the things they are remotely configuring. With my remote support, they are configuring, MSCTCL engineers itself are configuring the substations. And there are 10 substations we have done it, more than 10 substations they themselves done it. So only we have involved actually one substation during the commissioning. So second is the Suzlon Monitoring Center. This is the big SCADA. Where Suzlon are having around 100 substations and their windmills are there across the India. So we wanted to take all these data, wind data and substation data, and all the data can be sent it to the Suzlon Monitoring Center. This is called SMC Pune. There are many engineers are sitting and seeing the different states data. So that's what we have done it. Like you can see the more visuals, like something like the control center can see like this entire India map, and they can click on a particular state. Under the state, you can see the different windmills. If you want to see the mill, you can click on the mill. You can see the parameters of the wind speed, wind rotation, voltage, ambient temperature, all the wind parameters, turbine parameters you can see. Or you want to connect on the substation, you can connect and see the substation event, substation signal and diagram, all these things can be done it here. Like this you can see here. This is what we have done it in the Suzlon. And third one is the Power Grid also we have done same way. Say, similar way, Power Grid also facing the same issue. What happened in Jind 400 KV, there are already the OEM has installed the SCADA software with the existing base. And over the period, Power Grid has come up with the extension base. And these extension bays cannot be integrated with the existing SCADA. And they are trying to, the existing bays are the extension bays ke liye separate software they are using. And the existing system, they are using the software. And they cannot integrate both together. So they are facing a lot of problems. And when they are contacting with the original manufacturer, which has already done. So they are asking a huge money for integration of these things. That's what Power Grid has come up with us, come up with these issues and discuss with us. So we have completely, we have given our SCADA system where existing all their base, 400 kV, 220 kV base, and the extension base also complete all the base we have integrated in single software in our system. And we have whatever the automation we want to do it in the earlier system, same thing we have done it in our system without the OEM help. All these things, because even the Power Grid is having their own control, so they also know that how to configure the relays end. So that with that small help from the customers, we have done complete automation. So now the Power Grid Jin, our SCADA is a single platform where they can see the existing base as well as the extension base in the single platform, and they get the all alarms, all the whatever the SCADA features they are earlier getting, everything, and additional features also we are getting. That's what you get the advantage when you go for the standalone SCADA, where they give a lot of features to you. But when it comes to a combination of package, so the guys will tell you that, okay, so if you are taking my SCADA, these are the standard features, you have to use it. If you are asking some extra features or extra modification, they will not give it to you, or they will charge you that modification charges or development charges. That's what the flexibility being standalone SCADA, you have more flexibility. This is what Power Grid we have done it. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you. Please.
Slides, actually, there is a small technical glitch where slides cannot, the rest of the next slide is not showing. Anyway,
no.
This is what we are doing. And additionally, we are also doing Atidas project where all the distribution okay, what I'm saying, we are also doing the Atidas project where the distribution segment, all the SIDES FE can be monitored. So all these 11 kV or 33 kV substations, around 100 and 200 substations, they are taking the data, installing RTU at the field end and sending those data to the control center, where the control center SCADA will take the data, and there is one module we provide for them is the SIDES FE module. Though this SIDES FE will normally a index, consumer satisfaction index. Nowadays the central government is asking every distribution company to have their own SIDES FE indexes. So that's what we are doing. 3-4 electricity boards, around 1,000 substations all together, they are doing this project in the RTDash scheme. This is what we are doing, and the case studies on what we are doing. And apart from this, there are many other areas we are doing that, but these are the specific things we wanted to highlight to you so that you will learn or you will understand something from this installation. That's what I just wanted to showcase these projects. So with this, I think I am done with my presentation. We can go ahead with the question answer session. Okay, question answer session. So, Sushil, you can take the questions. What are the different questions your attendees are asking? So, you can take those one by one question and we can explain to them. Okay, I see one question from Mr. George. He is asking that, okay, do we need separate system for protection, control, or metering data? I think you don't require it. So everything will be in one platform, or there are two options. Either you want to make a separate system, you can make separate three servers, put protection data for one server, control and metering for the other two servers, or you want everything to be a one system, so you can even still make those system. So this is something like a, you, I mean to say that our system should be a distributed one. So you want to distribute each and every application a separate system, you can do it still. If you don't want that system, everything should be on one system, you can still do it. That's what one should support, this type of distribution, distributed architecture. I think I answered your question, Mr. George. And one more question being posed here. This, please, Mr. Srinivasan, please explain on database software used. So I explained you, like earlier I was explaining you about this database. So we normally support all the database like OTBS database or Oracle SQL database, MySQL, Microsoft MySQL, or even we support Dell database. All these open database, the major database we support. And when you choose SCADA system, you should also see that what are the database you are using already and what are the database you are going to use in future. Keep in those database in your mind and you select in your SCADA system. That's way you in future integration you easily integrate with your SCADA database with the other database systems. And to transfer the database, we support one OPC protocol. We also support ICCP protocol. I think I answered your question, Mr. Srinivas.
Hello.
Yeah. And tell me, Sushil.
There was one more question from Srinivasan, sir. Does Scopes software acquired with the different protocols simultaneously? For example, IC61850 Modbus DLMS. Yes, sir. Our software can acquire data simultaneously over different type of protocol. They are not linked with each other. It can, from one channel, it can acquire data from 61850. From other channel, it can acquire data over Modbus. So it is like that. It is getting data simultaneously over different protocol on different networks and different channels. Next is, if I have,
there is Deepan, a one point. Mr.
Okay,
okay. Yeah. Okay, Mr. Deepan, question is, like wind energy, whether it is possible to monitor or control the devices on solar power plant? Absolutely. Anything, see, SCADA is not restricted to one system. See, anything which you are giving a data to through the sensor to, on open protocol, which can be taken to the SCADA and put it on the, publish on the SCADA system. So it is not very restricted to the one application. You can use solar plant, you can use wind plant, windmills, you can use the water system, you can use the sewage system, you can use the electrical system. The system is SCADA should have to take the data on the open or standard protocol. That's the main important here. Yes, Sushil.
Next question is, wait a second. If I have 11 kV 3 number of feeder and there is no any communication facility, how can I convert it into monitoring system without changing whole? Sir, you need not to change the whole system. You just need to change your relay and put a Ethernet switch, and you can make it a monitoring system likewise. Means you don't need to change all the system. You just need to retrofit your relay and some additional hardware. You can change it up to its automation system. There is a one question. What is percentage wise cost of scope SCADA compared to traditional OM SCADA? Sir, we will answer this question over mail. That will be great option for us. Okay. Then, okay. There is a one question from JK Prajapati. Do SAS signal standard load SCADA server and make SAS hanging frequently? No, sir. The SAS system signal standardization is not loading the SAS system, but again, when there is a lots of data, number of data points or number of communication point increase, it can load your SAS system. So when you are going to design a SAS system or network system, you have to design it likewise that whatever data your substation is given, you have to build a server according to that. So standardization doesn't load your server. It's just a data point, type of data point that will be loading your server. Okay.
There is another question is, Mr. Srinu asks again, is NMS built in scope SAS software? For this, actually NMS ke liye, the network management system, for if it is your system is very small, having not less than 50 to 60 devices, for small system, our software will support you NMS. But if you go to the big system, like lot of servers, lot of redundancy, and complicated network, better we should go for the standalone or standalone network NMS system. But normal small systems, our inbuilt SCADA have NMS, which will take care of small systems. Any other question, Sushil, you want to discuss, or all the questions are answered, then we can
there was one question. Yes, sir, there is one question. Can two different make SCADA system can be interlinked? Yes, sir, we can interlink two make of SCADA system when there is a open protocol available with the both of SCADA. Suppose one SCADA can talk to any other SCADA if it is having open protocol like OPC, like 104 and all other protocols, or maybe ICCP. So if there is a protocol availability between both SCADA, it can be interlinked. When we are saying it is interlinked, means data transfer can be done from one SCADA to other SCADA. And more thing I want to add, that we have not answered all of your question. We might be answering other questions via mail. Bhaskar sir, up to you.
Yeah, okay. With this one, if any questions are left out, we will be sending to their personal mail ID or to the proper channel. We will be sending all these questions and answers to you all. So with this one, I would like to thank you all for attending this particular session on SCADA, and I hope you understand or you get something from this session, and we are very thankful to you and your time. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.